Hello guys, how are you doing? I'm Mohammad Sadri, postdoctoral researcher at Microelectronics System Design Research Group of TU Kaiserslautern. This is lesson 4 that we are creating for the ZYNQ device, and it is titled ZYNQ AXI Interfaces Part 2. And actually in this lesson we are going to do a very simple experiment in which we will use the AXI master GP0 and GP1 ports of the ZYNQ device to write something to a very simple, in fact, block memory in the PL, and then to read the data back. So this is the block diagram. Actually, I have shown you a lot of time during the previous videos, and just to review what we are going to do in this video, I'm going to show it to you again once more. What I'm going to do in this video is that I'm going to, in fact, transfer some data from my ARM host that I have here. Okay, so I have my ARM host here, and I'm going to transfer some data from my ARM host to through this AXI master GP0 and GP1 port to an AXI slave that I have on the PL. So practically what I'm going to do is that with the ARM host, I'm going to perform some write transactions through the GP0 port to a simple block memory which is located at the PL, and then from the GP1 port, I'm going to read the data back from that block memory to the ARM host. So we are going to see how we design this hardware using Vivado environment and how we develop a simple piece of software that will be executed on the ARM host that we have here, and it will perform the job that we want for us. So the important point is that if I look, in fact, at the ZYNQ architecture, each piece of hardware that we have in the ZYNQ has an address. So from the viewpoint of the ARM host, when it wants to access different components in the ZYNQ system, each of these components has an address, and the ARM host can use this address to access those components. Now, for the MGP1 and MGP0 port, that are the AXI master ports that we have on the boundary of the ZYNQ PS and the ZYNQ PL. For these ports also we have an address. And the addresses, they are indicated, in fact, in the ZYNQ documentation. Here, I'm showing you a piece of this documentation. So what you see here, in fact, is the table which is representing the addresses for each piece of hardware that we have, in fact, on the ZYNQ device. We have different pieces of hardware, such as DRAM memory, which is connected to the DRAM controller, which is located in the PS. Then we have, in fact, as I told you, the GP0, GP1 port, which are practically connected to the PL of the ZYNQ device, and we can transfer data from the ARM host to the PL through them. And then we have some other pieces of hardware, such as, for example, QSPI flash, or different, in fact, IO peripherals. So each of these guys, they have an address. And for now, for this video, the addresses that we will be, in fact, dealing with and the addresses that we will see during our experiments are the one that I have indicated in the red rectangular block. So these are the addresses. The first one is the addresses that I can use, in fact, to access the GP0 port and to perform read-write transactions to GP0 port. And then the second one is the addresses that I can use to access the GP1 port. Okay, for this experiment, I'm going to use a set of design tools. First, obviously, I'm going to use the Vivado environment to create my hardware. That's an easy task, and we will see soon how easy it is. Then, for developing the software that will be executed on the ARM host, I will use the Xilinx SDK environment. Again, we will see how I am going to do that. And one important point is that I'm running this whole, in fact, infrastructure that I have for development on the Linux. And you can use Windows also for this. So the Vivado environment and the software development kit, they both come for both of the Linux and Windows. But I really like Linux, so I'm going to do all of these tasks on Linux. And then we have a very nice and useful tool with which we can debug the software that we are running, in fact, on the ARM host, and it's called XMD, Xilinx Microprocessor Debugger, I think. And this tool we also use during the development. Okay, so what I'm going to do today is that I use the Vivado environment, I design my hardware, and I create a bit stream. So I use the Vivado environment, I create a block diagram, is actually my hardware, and then I go through synthesis, implementation, and bitstream generation. Then I use the software development kit, and I write a very simple piece of code that will transfer some data from, in fact, the PS to the PL, and then read the data back to the PS. And I, for this task, I use the Xilinx software development kit, and I create, in fact, a set of TCL files. I will show you these TCL files I use mainly for initialization of the ZYNQ PS, and then I create an ELF file, which is the main executable of my program. And then what I'm going to do is that I have a notebook, I have my ZC706 board, and then I connect this ZC706 board through the JTAG cable and through a UART cable to my notebook, and then I will run my application on ZC706 to see if it is working or not. Okay, this is a very simple example, is a kind of introductory example for people who are just getting familiar. This board can do much more, and in future videos, we'll even do some PCI Express interfacing using the same board. But for now, we want to keep everything simple and easy to understand. Later in the next and future videos, I will focus also on, in fact, developing some AXI master blocks and then transferring some data through HP ports to the memory subsystem of the ARM. One silly question that people may ask, and actually is not a correct question, but people may ask, is that what are the addresses for these HP ports? So these two, GP0 and GP1 port, they have an address. As I showed you, the first one is beginning from an address, the second one is beginning from another address. What does this mean? This means that whenever the ARM host wants to access these ports, it will perform transaction to those addresses. The point is that these guys, they don't have any address. They don't need any address. They are slave ports. And for the slave port, actually the master can perform transactions through this slave port to whatever address that it wants. Okay? So these guys, they don't need an address. Just those ports who are master ports for the PL, and in fact slave ports for the ARM host, they need an address. Okay? So let's get started with the practical part of this video. Okay, now we've reached the practical part of this session, and I want to create, in fact, a simple project that I was talking about using Vivado. So what I do, in my command prompt, I just issue the Vivado tool, and now I'm using kind of latest version of Vivado that is available at the moment. So the Vivado tool is running, and I'm creating a new project. And as you see, I'm using the ZC706, so I just press next, right ahead, and I don't care about any of these configurations that we have in the project. Later, if you've needed any of them, you can, in fact, come back and load the sources that you want. So here is our, in fact, project created, and the first step I do, I create a block design. So I create a block design. And in my block design, what I do, I insert, in fact, a ZYNQ PS. So I put a ZYNQ processing system. Let's make this dialog box bigger so that I can make sure I am selecting the correct option. Okay, now the ZYNQ PS is here, and as you put this block here, inside your block diagram, an option appears on the top of the block diagram. It's called Run Block Automation. And actually, this is the dialog box which, when you press OK, performs all of the, in fact, automatic configurations that is required for this block in the hardware. So later, we need also some configuration which is required for this block in the software. We will talk about it later. But the hardware part, for example, the connection to the DRAM memory, as you see, is done automatically by the tool. You don't need to do it by hand. all of these parts, they will be automatically done by the tool. So I have the ZYNQ PS, and now I add, in fact, the block memory that will be implemented on the PL and is responsible for receiving my data at write time and then giving back the data at read time. So I say, I search for BRAM, and I put AXI BRAM controller, okay? And now I need the block memory himself. The item that I just inserted into my block diagram is the AXI memory controller. It's not the BRAM itself. So you need the block memory generator. So I put also this item here. And then, since I want to write from GP0 port and read from GP1 port, I need two AXI BRAM controllers, and I should configure my block memory as a dual port memory. So I double click here on the BRAM, and I say I want to have a true dual port RAM. So this is a true dual port RAM, and I insert another AXI BRAM controller, AXI BRAM controller, and now for each of these AXI BRAM controllers, I configure them to, in fact, get connected to one of the ports of the BRAM memory. So I double click here, and I say I want this guy to have just one BRAM side port, and also for this guy, I want to have just BRAM point, one BRAM. This is a very effective method with which you can share the data between different parts of your hardware. In fact, you have one block memory, to enable both of the ports of the block memory, and then to have two AXI BRAM controllers, and these AXI BRAM controllers, they get connected to this block memory, and each of these AXI BRAM controllers will get connected to a completely different location in your hardware, and you can effectively share or copy the data between different parts of the hardware using this method. Okay, I use it a lot. So now is the connection time. I need to connect all of these guys together, and that's actually very simple. I again use the help of Vivado. I press run connection automation, and then I enable all of the guys that I have here, and I just briefly, in fact, review what kind of connection automation the Vivado will do for each of these blocks. So here, for BRAM port A, I see that, in fact, BRAM port A, let's look, where is it? BRAM port A on AXI BRAM controller, it will get connected to block memory GEM0. Okay, this is something I want. Then the AXI slave port of AXI BRAM controller 0, it gets connected to GP0 port of the Vivado. Again, this is something I want. Then BRAM port A of AXI BRAM controller 1, as you see here, it will get connected to block MEM Gen 0. Again, this is something I want, is good for me. And here, I see that in this connection automation, again, the tool is going to automatically connect this AXI slave port to the GP0 AXI master port of the PS. This is something I don't want. Indeed, as I told you, I want to get connected, I want to make connection between this AXI BRAM controller and GP1. Not GP0. Okay, so for this one, let's exclude this one, the final one, and let's ask Vivado to do all of the rest of the connection automations. Okay, now let's arrange all of the items so that we can see them effectively and clearly. Okay, so as you see, Vivado has made all of the required, in fact, connections for you. Here we have the MAXI GP0 port. There is an AXI interconnect. Don't forget, there is always an AXI interconnect between your AXI master port and AXI slave port. Okay, this is the default behavior. Yes, I agree that sometimes in very exceptional cases you want to drop the AXI interconnect, but that is something you do by hand and you do very carefully, and actually that's something you do when you really know what you are doing. So in the default case, there's always an AXI interconnect between your AXI master and AXI slaves. Then I have the AXI interconnect. The AXI interconnect correctly has one AXI master port, and that is connected to S AXI port of BRAM controller. And then this BRAM controller is connected to BRAM port A, and the other BRAM controller is connected to BRAM port B. And then there's the block here, which is kind of very interesting block and is responsible for producing the reset signal for all of the pieces of your hardware. Actually, this block is producing two reset signals. One reset signal is getting produced for, they call it interconnect asynchronous reset, active low, and it's the reset which is being generated for all of your AXI interconnects. And the other reset which is being produced by this block, they call it peripheral asynchronous reset, active low, and this guy is responsible, in fact, for going to peripherals or other blocks that you have in your hardware. And who is driving this block? Actually, this block is driven by the reset signal, which is coming from the ZYNQ PS, and also it's using the clock signal, which is coming from the PS. So actually, the reset and clock that I use for my circuit in the PL, both of these signals, they come directly from the ZYNQ PS, okay? And this is a kind of very common situation. So in most of the designs that you have for the Xilinx ZYNQ, the logic that you have on the PL will be driven by the clock, which is coming from the PS, and this is something really good. Why? Because then you have, if you double click on this block, on the ZYNQ PS block here, then you have a configuration interface. And then on this configuration interface, there's the clock configuration section. And then in the clock configuration section, there's the PL fabric clock, in which you can very easily change, select, and change the clock frequency with which you want to drive the hardware that you have on the PL. So right now, the clock frequency that we have on F-clock clock 0 is 50 MHz, and you can change it to 100 MHz or any other number that you want. Actually, since there is a kind of PLL running there, it's not you can set it to any number that you want, but you have a very wide range of choices. Okay, so it's a kind of clock which is being configured by your software, okay? And this is very easy to use. Yes, there are cases in which I need to have clock directly entering the PL. For example, suppose that your board, this is 706, is going to connect to get connected to PCI Express slot, and then you have a clock which is coming over PCI Express, which is entering your board, and that clock, that differential clock, will enter your ZYNQ PL directly, and then it enters your PCI Express block, and then it spreads along the rest of the blocks that you have in your PL. This is a kind of exceptional case that we have, and the clock is actually not coming from the PS, it's coming from the PL directly. But in most of the cases, most of the designs that we have, the clock is being driven through these F clock 0 port and F clock 1, F clock 2, 3 ports, which are being directly driven from the ZYNQ PS. And then later, in the software, which is being generated by the tool for, in fact, initial configuration of the ZYNQ PS, you will see that in that software, there is a section, there is a portion in which the software configures the registers which are responsible for defining the operation of the PLL, okay? So it's a kind of software configurable clock generation system. And by changing that piece of software there, you can change the clock frequency. And when in this interface here, I am changing the clock frequency, what's practically changing is the contents of those registers, which are responsible for configuring the PLL. Okay, that is enough for the clock for now. And the point is now I have the AXI BRAM controller 1, and I want to connect it to the GP1 port of the ZYNQ. For that, I double click here, and I enable the GP1 port of the ZYNQ PS. So PSPL configuration, then I come to GP master AXI interface. GP0 is by default enabled, and now I enable GP1. GP1 is enabled, I press OK. And now we see GP1 here, and now I have the run connection automation option. I set, and then I select SAXI port of AXI BRAM controller 1. Actually, this is this port, which is now connected, which is not connected at the moment to anywhere. And here, I ask the tool to make a connection between this port and the GP1 port. So I press OK. Now, what's Vivado going to do? The Vivado will add another AXI interconnect to the system. this AXI interconnect will actually be the interconnect between the GP1 port of the ZYNQ PS and the rest of the logic that you have on the PL. So this AXI interconnect, as you see, has one AXI slave port. This AXI slave port is connected to GP1, and then it has one AXI master port, and this AXI master port is connected to AXI BRAM controller 1, and as I told you before, this AXI BRAM controller 1 is going to get connected to the second port of your block memory. So actually, the block memory is a kind of medium through which you can share data between GP1 and GP0. This is a very simple case, very simple example. But as you begin designing, you can see that it's a really effective method to share data between different pieces of hardware. OK, so this is the hardware block diagram. It's kind of complete. Let's double check the clock and reset signals together and make sure that all of the clock and reset signals that we need are connected. This is usually a mistake that happens during creating such kind of block diagram. Now, the block diagram is complete. Another point that we should focus on is actually the addresses. The addresses through which the ZYNQ PS, the AXI masters that I have here, will see these two components. I should make sure that the address configuration, which is created by Vivado automatically for this block diagram, is correct. For that, for every block diagram that you sketch, there are two tabs. The first tab is the diagram tab. The second tab is the address editor. I come to the address editor, and actually, in this design, I have one major master. I have this ZYNQ PS, who is the one who is going to produce all of these AXI transactions. Okay? So for this initiator of AXI transactions, there are a set of slaves. The slaves are indicated here. So I open up this button, and then we have AXI BRAM control 0, AXI BRAM control 1, and the tool has assigned automatically a set of addresses to each of these two components. So the tool has assumed that the ARM host will see AXI BRAM control 0 at this address, 0x4, the rest of them are 0. And then AXI BRAM control 1 at this address, 0x4000 to 000. The question is if this configuration is correct. Let's back to the block diagram. Here in this block diagram, if I look, I can see that AXI BRAM control 1 is practically a slave of the GP1 port. And if you look back at the presentation that I showed you and the table which was containing the addresses for different blocks in the hardware, you can see that the address range for GP1 port is practically beginning from 0x8000000. So if the addresses for this port is beginning from 0x8, then can this configuration be correct? The answer is no. This configuration is not correct. This address value is not correct. The tool has assigned an address to your AXI block automatically when you did the connection automation. But this address is not correct, and you should modify it. So for now, I modify it to 0x8, the rest of the items are 0. And where do I bring this number from? I bring this number from the table that I showed you in the first part of the video. So the takeaway here is that you use the connection automation, you use the block automation, in fact, facilities that Vivado gives to you to accelerate designing your hardware and to ease the design of the hardware. But the point is, you should always be careful about what the tool performs for you automatically. You should always double check what the tool is doing, and you should always observe what the tool is doing, because necessarily, the thing that the tool does for you is not what you want. Maybe it is completely wrong and you should change something. Okay? So our design is kind of complete. and I think the addresses are now in a better situation. And I can go through the rest of the flow in which I come here. I first save this sync that I have created. Then I come here to the sources. Then I right click on my infact design and I say create HDL wrapper. And then I say let Vivado manage wrapper and auto update. This is a default and as of my experience, the best option. So I just press OK, and I look carefully at the log of the tool to make sure that there are no strange warnings or there are no error messages. This is usually one point that when you create a block diagram, you will encounter, in fact, errors or problems that your block diagram has. OK, so far I think it's all fine. Here I have a warning. It says that the address that this guy is putting on this port is 32-bit, but the address that this guy is fetching out of that 32 bits is only, in fact, 13 bits. So the 32 bits address is going, but only the 13 lower bits are used. And this is kind of obvious. This is because of the size of this block memory that we have here. How did I configure the size of block memory that we have here? In fact, this configuration is here in your address editor. So by changing the size, in fact, the range of the address which is being seen by each of these AXI memory controllers, you are changing the size of that block memory. So if you want to change the size of the block memory, you don't double click here. By double clicking here, you cannot change the size of the block memory. What you do is you change the range of the addresses that you can see from the AXI BRAM controller, okay? And usually it's a good idea that if you change one, and they are both connected to one block memory, you also change the other, okay? So, block diagram, the warnings are okay. I have done, in fact, creation of HDL wrapper. So now look, there's a verilog file at the top of my design. This is a verilog file, is automatically generated. It contains a set of ports. These ports are, again, automatically generated. Basically, they are created at the time of block automation for the ZYNQ PS. And then here we have, in fact, the instantiation of our design. Okay, now we go to the next step in which we ask the tool to create the equivalent HDL, equivalent RTL for my entire design so that later I can go through the synthesis and implementation. So I right click here and I say generate output products. And as I do this, the tool goes, grabs the HDL code, the RTL code for each of these blocks that I'm using in my design, the ones that are appearing as a kind of soft core, brings them to the project folder and puts them together and creates a kind of consistent design that can be synthesized into the beta stream. So I select generate output product and I select generate. Okay, now we reached a step that says generation of output product completed successfully, and then I don't need this wrapper. Let's close it, and here is our block diagram. We go through the rest of the flow, which is run synthesis. So next, I press run synthesis, and after that, I can press run implementation, and after that, I can press generate beta stream. Okay, so we now temporarily pause the recording of the video. I just directly press the generate beta stream. The synthesis implementation beta stream generation will begin, and then I come back to you. Okay, now we have our beta stream generated and beta stream generation completed. And there are a set of things you can do here. You can open the implemented design and if you open the implemented design, the first purpose for which I do that is to see, in fact, the timing result of the hardware. So your hardware should run at a specified clock frequency. So the delays across different parts of your circuit, they should not exceed the clock frequency. And a set of timing analysis will be done by the tool in order to assure that these timings are met. And so you can open implemented design and see this kind of timing results. So just to see what's happening, I open the implemented design. Okay. So the first thing that it will be shown to you at the time you open the implemented design is indeed a kind of symbolic representation for the placement of different objects across your ZYNQ device. So this is my ZYNQ device. Here I have, in fact, the ZYNQ PS and some interfaces. And then here is the programmable logic area. And here I have, in fact, different parts of the circuit that I have implemented on the PL part of the ZYNQ device. So basically, this area that you see here is the ZYNQ PL. And this area that you see here is basically the ZYNQ PS. Okay, now, here in the implemented design section, if I look, there are a set of, in fact, possibilities that I can select. One very useful is report timing summary. So you click report timing summary, and there are a set of options that you can configure, and that, but eventually it will give you a kind of summary on the timing of your circuit. And you can, in fact, go through it, analyze it, and see if all of the timing constraints are met. I want, in fact, my hardware is now ready. And now that I have the hardware ready, I have the bitstream generated, I export this hardware configuration to the software development kit environment. So I come to the file menu, export, export hardware, and I press OK. And then after that, I come again here and I launch SDK. I have just opened the SDK window. And from the file menu, now you can begin an application project. I begin an application project. I call it Hello. And then for this Hello application project that I have here, as the type of the application, I select a simple Hello World application. So we create this, and as you create this, the tool automatically compiles this application for you and all of its related files. And there's one important point here. If you are using Ubuntu, in fact, for the first time, and maybe you have a fresh install of the Ubuntu, and then you have installed, in fact, Xilinx Vivado tool set on Ubuntu, then this doesn't work. This doesn't run. You need to do something at your Ubuntu side so that the Vivado begin compiling your application. Otherwise, when you open this software development kit environment, you will encounter a large number of errors. And actually, the point is that when you look here, the application, the compiler that is really compiling my code is called arm-xilinx-eabi-gcc. And this guy, in order to be executed, it needs the 32-bit libraries. So if you have your Ubuntu installation, the 32-bit libraries, they are not there. This guy cannot get executed. It is there, but it cannot get executed. You will encounter an strange message from your operating system and also your software development kit environment. It doesn't work at all. So there are a set of, in fact, additional packages that you need to, in fact, install. And they are 32-bit libraries for some specific tasks. So don't forget to do that if this is the first time you are doing. And now I have my Hello 2 application here. And I want to, in fact, develop a simple code that writes some data to the block memory through GP0 and reads some data from GP1, the same data that I have written through GP0. In order to do that, I just begin modifying, in fact, the hello world.c program, which is created automatically by the tool. Here I have init platform, and the important point is that if I'm testing my application over the JTAG cable, as you see here, I'm connecting from my notebook through JTAG cable to the ZC706 board. Then, if I'm doing that, I need explicitly to say to, in fact, my hardware that I want you to enable, in fact, the clock, which is going from the PS to the PL, and I want you to enable the interfaces that are existing between the PS and the PL. So by default, when you turn on the ZYNQ device, when you initialize the PS, the interfaces between the PS and the PL, they are not active. The level shifters between PS and PL, they are not active. The clock, which is going from the PS to the PL, it is not active. And you should explicitly instruct, in fact, your ARM host to enable that clock and enable those level shifters. And how do you do that? There is a function already there, ready to use for you to do that kind of task. And that function is located inside ps7_init.c. Okay, so what I do usually is that I just copy these two files, copy. And as I copy these two files, so I hope it's copied. As I copy these two files, I paste them here into my project. And as I have them here, I can, in fact, include the ps7_init.h here. So let's do it, include ps7_init.h. And now I can call the function that I was talking about. So I think I can say here, I can say ps7, it's called ps7 postconfig. Okay, now I have the routine that I want. I can compile my application by saving, in fact, the modified C file and making sure that everything is fine. Now, another change that I like to make here is that I don't like the print function of the studio.h, in fact, library. I like the lovely printf. So there is Xilinx underline printf. I usually use that, and as of my experience, it is more stable. So I change the print to zil printf. Again, I save my application. I make sure that inclusion is correct. Now, what I want to do, we reach, in fact, the main part of our program. I want to write some data from here, in fact, to the logic that I have on the PL. And in order to do that, I should perform a set of writes to the address of GP0. And what was the address of GP0? I have the address of GP0 in my block diagram. But the point is, if here I come to hello2.bsp, so my project is called hello2, and along with hello2, if another folder gets created for you automatically, which is called hello2_bsp, and it contains a ps7_cortex_a9_0 folder. And if you go inside this folder, you can find a set of include files and a set of libraries. And if you look at the set of include files that you have here, you can find a file which is called xparameters.h. So I find the xparameters.h file if I find it here. And then I open, in fact, this file to see what is containing inside. Looking at the xparameters.h, you can see that this file contains all of the important addresses and all of the important parameters of your hardware. For example, the address at which I can find that block memory to write data to through the GP0 port is here. And I can go, in fact, through this file and find it. If I look at the file, I find this parameter, xpar, axi, brm, control, 0s, axi, base address. And this is the address I'm looking for. So what I want to do, I want to perform a set of write operations to this address. So let's copy this address and keep it inside, in fact, my C program. Now, soon I will complete this piece of line that I am creating here. Now, I want to perform an out operation to this address. And in order to do that, you can use the set of functions that are already developed by Xilinx. So if I look at these files, at these header files that I have here, I should find a kind of file related to I/O, and this file should be able to help me for my read-write operations. There's a file here. It's called zil_io. Let's make it open. This, in fact, header file contains a set of functions that you can use for your read-write operations. Here are the list of functions that you can use. Here I have zil in and I have zil out. And the zil out I can use for output operations. The zil in I can use for reading from somewhere in the memory. The zil out for writing to somewhere in the memory. So zil_out32 is the function that I want to use right now for my specific purpose. So I copy this, I come to, in fact, the program that I am writing for my ARM host, and then I do a very simple, in fact, programming experience. I create a for loop for a variable. The for loop actually goes from 0 to 10. And then inside the for loop, I want to have, in fact, a set of out operations. The address. The address is the address of the block memory. So I select this value. This is our address. I'll put it here. And each time for each write, I increase the address by 4. So the first time, I want to write exactly at the base address, which is the first line of the block memory. The next time, I want to write to the next line of the block memory, so the address will be incremented by 4 bytes. So here is the address and then the value. For the value, let's write something, for example, I plus 0xAABBCCDD. Okay, this is for now my program, and up to now, in fact, this program is supposed to perform the write operations through GP0 to the block memory. In order to make it complete, let's add the x parameters, xparameters.h to the story, and make sure that the program gets compiled without any problem. Now, after this write operation, I want to perform the read operation. There is one important note here. This is just what we are doing a practice. Each of the GP1 and GP0 port can perform both of read and write operations. So in your practice, you can write through GP1, read through GP0, or vice versa. This is just a practice that shows you how you can use these ports and how you can transfer data between your ARM host and the hardware that you have on the PL. So another for loop is responsible for, in fact, reading these data through the GP1 port and printing them out on the screen so that we can make sure that the operation is done correctly. So this is the second for loop, and here I need to use the zil_in32 function. So I say zil printf and then value at address is, for example, the value. Okay, and now I can complete my printf parameters. The address value, in fact, is the address of GP1 plus the offset. And for the address of GP1, I can come here to my file and I can look here. the base address for AXI VRAM controller 1. So this is the address. I bring it here. This is the address value plus I might multiply by 4. And the value is exactly something similar. Xilinx input, and then here from the for the address, we have the base address plus I multiply by 4. So here is, in fact, my program is kind of ready, and it performs 10 writes, and then it performs 10 reads. The writes through GP0, the reads through GP1. Now I can go ahead and try this program and see if it is working or not. In order to do that, I first turn on my ZC706 board, and then I come, in fact, to the command prompt, and I clean up my command prompt so that we can clearly see what we are doing. Okay, I have in the project folder. I am in the project folder, and now I have a set of files which are important for testing my application on the board. The first file which is important is the bitstream. So I find the bitstream. Find from here every file which is finishing with .bit. Okay? So this is the first file which is important. And then another file which is important is the initialization file for the, in fact, ZYNQ PS. And then the final file which is important is the ELF file of the application. Okay, I use the XMD environment to load these files to the board. So find PS7 underline init.tcl, and then find every ELF file that you have. Okay, now I can run XMD. And I can program my hardware, FPGA, I think minus F, and then the address to the bitstream file I put here. I press enter. My FPGA gets programmed, so my FPGA is now ready. The logic is now on the PL. Of course, the interface between the PS and the PL is off. You can always check that your logic is programmed by looking at the down pin on your FPGA. Now that this is done, I initialize, in fact, the ZYNQ PS. So I say connect ARM hardware. I connect to the ARM debugging subsystem. And then I load the TCL script, which is responsible for initialization of the ZYNQ PS. This is the file here. And I use this file. Okay, so I call PS7 init. As I do that, in fact, the initialization of the PS gets done, and now the PS of the ZYNQ is now completely ready to run the application. Now, for the application to be executed, I need to load it, in fact, to the memory of the ARM, so that the ARM can access that application. And for that purpose, I use the do command. The do command reads your ELF on your notebook and copies through the JTAG cable that ELF to your, in fact, the memory of your hardware. So I use the do command, and then here I have the ELF file hello2.elf. So I copy this, I paste it here, and we have the ELF file loaded. The final step is, in fact, to run the application and to see the output of the application executed on the ARM host and to see if it is working correctly or not. In order to see the output of the application, obviously we should see the outputs which are produced by Xilinx printf function. And here I have a connection between one of the UART outputs that we have on the ZC706 board and my computer. Now, I want to see the output of my program, and in order to do that, I can use either the Minicom or Picocom or any other terminal program that you have. So here I am using Minicom. So the command is sudo minicom -s. You obviously run this program at super user mode so that it can have access to the serial port of the device. And then you make sure that the serial port setup is correct. So for my case, I have TTY USB 1, I think. And then I have the hardware flow control, no, and software flow control, no. And then the baud rate and the rest of the things, they are correct. So I save my configuration, and I go after that to the Minicom environment. If your serial port, in fact, your USB port was not correct, then you can always find the correct USB port through the, in fact, dmesh command of the Linux kernel. So you can issue dmesh command, and you can see the log of the Linux kernel to see which is the USB port which is corresponding, in fact, to the UART port of your device. So another, in fact, thing that I have found through experiment, in fact, useful is that you disconnect and connect the cable to your notebook to make sure that the USB interface is getting recognized by the tool. Now I have the Minicom. It's ready. It can show me the output of my program is connected to board over TTY USB 0. This TTY USB 0 or 1, it changes over time. So every time you connect it to your notebook, you may end up a different TTY. These are problems. Obviously, they are there for debugging your application, but you can solve them easily. Now, using the do command, in fact, I have loaded my program as I showed you. And now what I can do, I can issue the run command. And then as I issue the run command, I can come back here to the output of the program and see if the output that I have here for the program makes sense to me or not. I think that in the program that we had, if we were putting also a backslash r in the printf function, it was good. But as you see, here is the output. And these are the values which are being practically written through the GP0 port. And I'm reading them back through GP1 port. And as you see, I am reading relevant values through GP1 port. That's showing that our hardware is working fine. As of one last test, I like to see if I can have a more clear output if I add the backslash r here. So I do this, I come back here, and I see if I can run this new application. So I say again do. I issued a stop command, sorry, it was running. I then say do, and then I say run, and see if it's, yeah. Now I have the clear output. These are the values we have read through GP1 port, and they have been written previously through GP0 port, and it clearly shows that our hardware is working. Okay, that is the end of this video. Future videos, we will have more serious applications and more serious experiments. But as a kind of beginning step, I think this is an interesting test to be done by you to make sure that you have understood all of the concepts completely. Thanks for watching, and see you in other videos. Bye.